Mr. Blonde. Mr. Orange.
Yeah.
Mr. Pink. Let's go to work.
Larry, stop pointing that gun at my dad!
Tonight, Channel 4 presents the first British television screening of Reservoir Dogs, the cult film that made director Quentin Tarantino an overnight sensation. It's about a diamond heist which goes horribly wrong in the hands of an oddball bunch of fast-talking Mr. Men and ends up a dog's breakfast of blood and betrayal as they suspect that one of them is an undercover cop. Originally, it was going to be made with just $10,000 of Tarantino's own money and a few of his friends as the cast. Then actor Harvey Keitel got hold of the script, read it, loved it, and helped raise some proper finance. The rest is movie history. Tonight's Film Night special from LA takes a fresh look at this much talked about film and asks what impact Reservoir Dogs has made on audiences and filmmakers 5 years on.
Right now, it's a matter of business. Under no circumstances do I want any one of you to relate to each other by your Christian names. All I want you guys to talk about, if you have to, is what you're gonna do. Let's go to work.
It is kind of an offbeat comedy. It's a black humor comedy.
It is an adaptation of Agatha Christie.
The violence troubles me.
It's going on television, which I feel very uncomfortable about.
You bought in England, you bought in France, you bought in Italy, you bought in Tokyo, you bought in Hong Kong, you bought in Sydney.
It's not a chick film. This ain't no date movie.
Reservoir Dogs is a good product. Looking for some happiness, but there's only loneliness
to find. I met Quentin standing online for a midnight feature of a 3D movie, which I don't remember the name of. He says, look, I have this great idea for a script and for a movie. It's called Reservoir Dogs. I go, wow, cool title. About a bunch of guys who hang out in a garage, and, you know, they pull a jewelry heist, but you never see the jewelry heist. It's a one-location movie. And they come back to the garage, and one guy's been shot, one guy's been killed, one guy's a traitor. And so, wow, this is a really good idea for a low-budget movie. So I drove over to his house. He lived with his mom. And he was sort of, you know, doing the typewriter and everything. And I was sort of reading it as it was coming off the press, basically, and it was really cool. Of course, he spelt everything phonetically. It was kind of funny, but it was really, I was like, wow, this is really just really exciting stuff.
Hey, your name. Mr. Brown, Mr. White, Mr. Blonde, Mr. Blue, Mr. Orange, Mr. Pink.
Why not Mr. Pink?
Because you're a faggot, all right?
What he's done is adapt Agatha Christie. A traditional crime story begins with two events. One, the crime is committed, then the crime is discovered. What Agatha Christie does, of course, is cut to the second half of that. The crime is discovered. A closet door opens and a body falls out. Now the reader has curiosity in two directions simultaneously. Into the past, how and why was this murder committed? Into the future, how will this turn out? Will they catch them? Who did it? What Tarantino did was then do the same thing. He cuts to the getaway. Cutting to the getaway with the wounded guy in the back seat, we know that the jewel heist now went wrong. We don't know why, we don't know how. And so he has curiosity again in both directions, into the past and into the future. And so that every time the pace slowed in the warehouse scenes, he could cut to these exciting episodes of the heist going wrong from various characters' points of view, and constantly then accelerate the pace of the film, satisfying the audience's curiosity into the past and amplifying then their curiosity into the future. How will this turn out? A more pedestrian writer would have shown you the heist go wrong. Would have started the movie with a bang. What he did was a kind of, you know, almost oriental discipline, which is, I'm not going to show you the most exciting scene in the film. Not yet. I'm going to make you wait.
Andre Sakua, right, never shot a movie He'd never shot a feature film. And we had seen like a little tape that he had done. And we thought this guy was brilliant. And it was between him and another guy.
I get a tip that Quentin Tarantino, at that time, first-time director, looking for director of photography for very low-budget movie. And it happened that I was in Los Angeles at that time, and I did have my showreel, because one of the purpose to coming to Los Angeles, like most filmmaker, is to find job in the mighty Hollywood, which I was always dreaming of. I get a call from Quentin saying, "Oh man, I love it absolutely. Your showreel, I would like to see you."
And we met with him, and he just wowed us. You know, we just were like, this is the guy.
Looking back on the track for a little green back. Got to find just a kind of losing my mind.
The main characters were working from end of the wall to the end. So they use this middle part.
I saw in the night and I saw it in the day. Looking back on the track, or to it my way.
Quentin used this place for working with actors. He said, "All my dogs, let's go to work."
Looking for some happiness, but there is only loneliness to find. To the left, to the right.
The theme is a theme of honor among thieves. What the film is about is an exploration of that premise. Is there, in fact, honor among thieves? It's something that we want to believe in for some twisted reason, to romanticize criminality, and of course it's bogus. What Tarantino's doing is something rather original, which is exploding the notion of honor among thieves. And the moment it's exploded, you realize how, you know, powerfully realistic that is, because of course there is no such thing as honor among thieves.
You're telling me that now that this man is free, and we're making good on our commitment to him, he's just gonna decide, out of the fucking blue, to rip us off? Why don't you tell me what really happened?
Well, originally he had planned to make Reservoir Dogs as a low-budget Super 8 movie. He was just gonna shoot it in Super 8 with his friends, and he shopped around the script probably everywhere. In fact, Roger Corman even himself passed on it, which I think was a bit of a mistake.
Once Bender got the script to Keitel, who was a high-profile actor, but never starred in a film that he carried, Keitel sniffed it out as his starring vehicle, and then Keitel said, "Yes, I'll do it." And then with that firm commitment from Keitel, not an interest, then they got the deal. That's how the Tarantino deal came out. Very few first-timers are going to be at that level and get that firm actor commitment.
Harvey called, and the second I heard his voice on a machine, I said, "You know what, this is going to get bigger than I thought." Harvey got really into it. We were casting in L.A., and Harvey said, "You know, guys, we got great actors here in L.A., you know, but you should really see the guys in New York, too, you know." And it was there that we actually saw Steve Buscemi. And Steve actually didn't give the greatest audition, but there was something about him that was so cool that I was like, this is the guy, you know?
"You want to shoot me, you little piece of shit? Go ahead, take a shot."
"Fuck you, White! I didn't create this situation, I'm dealing with it. You're acting like a first-year fucking thief. I'm acting like a professional."
Hollywood, of course, has this incredible reservoir of talent. I mean, behind every one of those actors stands a line, 100 deep, of quality actors that could have played those parts. But for a first-time director-writer to take a group of any actors, get these quality performances out of them, it was extraordinary.
"Your buddy there is stuck in a situation you created. So if you want to throw bad looks away, throw him out of the mirror."
"You kids shouldn't play so rough. Somebody's going to start crying."
"It's the blood."
With Michael Madsen, it was extraordinary, because when he delivered a line, he just finding the light for his advantage. For example, he was in light and he delivered dialogue about something, you know, and he a little bit slowly go into the shadow. There are small elements which added to the acting.
"Oh,
example, Tim Roth, he spent about 8 days in blood, just lying there, blood. Everybody have sort of break. Tim Roth was lying there because he could not move, because not to make too big mess. Because as film progressed, he's surrounded by bigger pool of blood.
You know what this is? It's the world's smallest violin playing just for the waitresses.
The dialogue and its style is critical to the film for this reason. Wit is the saving grace.
These people bust their ass. This is a hard job.
So is working at McDonald's, but you don't feel the need to tip them, do you? Well, why not? They're serving you food. But no, society says, don't tip these guys over here, but tip these guys over here. That's bullshit.
It's naturalistic, although none of the people of that class and world would actually talk like that, because it's very literary, too. It's very mannered in a certain way. It's the talk of someone who knows the dialogue in every film noir and every great comedy show.
What's the name of the chick who played Christy Love?
Pam Grier.
No, it wasn't Pam Grier. Pam Grier was the other one. Pam Grier did the film. Christy Love was like a Pam Grier TV show without Pam Grier.
So who was Christy Love?
The fuck should I know?
I think there's only a certain class of hoodlum he can hear, but he hears them beautifully.
For the past 15 minutes now, you've been droning on about names. Toby. 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 Toby Wong. Toby Wong. Toby Wong. Toby Chung. Fucking Charlie Chan. I've got Madonna's big dick coming out of my left ear, and Toby the Jap, I don't know what, coming out of my right.
Well, he's trying to make you see them as ordinary people, and I think if he, I don't know, but I'd guess he'd defend it by saying, look, this is how it is, and killers are just ordinary people, and they go to the dime store and they talk about waitresses and they order coffee just like everybody else. And I mean, the whole theory of the banality of evil, I think, is probably what he's playing with. But I don't think you can play with the idea of the banality of evil without saying there is more to it than that.
Hey, Joe.
Want me to shoot this guy?
Shit. You shoot me in a dream, you better wake up and apologize.
Brother bought a coconut, he bought it for the dime. His sister had another one, she baited for the lime. She put the lime in the coconut, she drank and pulled up. She put the lime in the coconut, she drank and pulled up. She put the lime in the coconut, she drank and pulled up.
We found this fabulous kind of period character warehouse. And then what the art department did was it was painted white. And we then thought, well, let's do, because we knew there was going to be all this red, the blood in it, let's do a color that would contrast with the red. So let's age it all green. And I don't know if it comes off to the audience, but it's supposed to be the back room of a mortuary. And that's why we have, in the background, there were wrapped caskets standing vertically. And then there was a gold hearse parked with a tarp over it, a clear plastic tarp. It was extremely hot, and it was pretty intense.
Stop! Stop!
What?
Don't.
What's the matter?
Don't do this!
Cut to 6 months or more later, the first press screening, the first official press screening for Reservoir Dogs. And I remember it vividly. Great screening room. Had about maybe 30, 40 of the top journalists in Los Angeles, including people from Time, Entertainment Weekly, Premiere. And it was really satisfying sitting up in the balcony and watching this film. And it was like, I knew cinema history had been made watching this thing. I mean, there's nothing like it that had happened. And the critics from Entertainment Weekly, Premiere, both got up and walked out. They just got up, vacated their seats, and left. And you could see this row of people just, you know, one after another, they'd pop up and they'd leave. And they were scared.
Ooga chaka, ooga, ooga, ooga chaka, ooga, ooga, ooga chaka, ooga, ooga, ooga chaka, ooga, ooga, ooga.
I can't stop this feeling.
Quite Quentin Tarantino was born blessed with talent, and all the years in the video store seeing all these other films, formulating something inside of his head, and trying the Hollywood system on how to get the deal, 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 and totally frustrated, chasing the deal, chasing the deal. And then he heard my tapes, and in my tapes, very quickly I say that when you make your first film and you're a nobody and you've never done it before, keep it simple. All directors say keep it simple too, but I'm the great film instructor. Now I explain what keep it simple is rather than say keep it simple.
I'm not going to tell you the formula story that springboards every independent filmmaker. Here's the standard formula that you do in 90 pages to keep it simple. You take 12 actors to a house and chop them up. How many times have you seen that movie? How many times? Take your actors to one location, a house.
And when Quentin Tarantino, I'm sure, heard me say take 12 people to a house, his Reservoir Dogs was take 12 actors to a garage and chop them up. That was the final fuel that he just said, I'm doing it. And that's what he told me later on. I really didn't teach him anything. All that stuff he knew already.
City on Fire is a film made by Ringo Lam that is basically the Hong Kong version of Reservoir Dogs before Reservoir Dogs existed.
Let's go to work.
I just want you to relax now, okay?
放心了，两位都。
The similarities are so apparent where actual shots are composed the same way. It's almost as if Tarantino used the film City on Fire as a template for Reservoir Dogs.
Mediocre artists borrow. Great artists steal and make better. And make better.
Reservoir Dogs would not have existed without Ringo Lam's contribution.
You don't need proof when you have instinct. I ignored it before, but no more.
If you kill that man, you die next. Repeat, if you kill that man, you die next.
You put that fucking gun down now.
Fact of the matter is, he took whatever he took, or wherever he got it, from his own insight or from others, it doesn't matter, and made something wonderful.
Storytellers have always borrowed and lifted and remembered things they've read in other stories, and it goes on all the time. I would never accuse him of being a plagiarist. He's got tons of originality, I think. The only thing I would say is that just as it's legitimate to borrow things from other films, it is legitimate to borrow things from real life, too. On the strength of Reservoir Dogs, I don't think he knows what and who women are.
Jesus!
Get the fuck out!
The use of women in the film is kind of odd. They're used almost like action man dolls. In one case, the Buscemi character comes around and he just stops his car and pulls the woman out through the windscreen. You don't even see her through the side window. In the second case, it's when Tim Roth comes up to get a car to get away. He stops a car and there's a woman inside it. He waves a gun and she, instead of getting out and just escaping to let him have the car, she reaches for the gun in the glove compartment.
Get a fucking car!
So she's been used completely as a kind of male figure almost. And that's it. You don't know anything more about her. You don't have any feeling about her. So they've both been used in very violent situations and they haven't been used as real characters. The women are not used as characters, as females, as women with feelings. They're just objects, or almost like dolls.
You ever listen to Kay Billy's Super Sounds of the 70s?
All of a sudden, of course, something happens in the film, like the ear scene, let's say, where you're suddenly taken and completely transported into a very nasty, frightening, tense situation.
The spirit of evil then permeates the film, and it is a very powerful and upsetting, to say the least, experience to be face to face with evil, with real sadistic celebration of violence and cruelty.
Well, I don't know why I came here tonight. I got the feeling of something right.
Clearly, Tarantino is preoccupied with violence. I mean, I think he's a little like Scorsese in the sense that I suspect neither of them is violent as a person. But they're very drawn to and very afraid of violence, and it fills their films.
I think it's a young man's film. I don't know if he'll go on and on doing this, but I think that is an attitude that is amongst young men and groups of young men. And they generally grow out of it, or grow out of gangs, and grow up.
Stop!
Please, look, I got a little kid wrong now, please.
Y'all done?
Don't!
I am completely opposed to censorship of all kind. I'm happy to think that British television is going to play the film with that scene. But I think there is a cruelty in the scene that is out of control. And I think it's an artistic weakness, if you like, but it's a weakness of taste beyond that.
Hold on, buddy boy.
Tarantino may very well be right that teenagers today will see it as a kind of almost as a spoof and go along with it. I don't know if they will or not. Certainly, unsophisticated kids of 8, 9, 10 won't see it that way because they won't get it. And I don't think it's enough to say parents will control what children see, because they don't. We know they don't.
It's just blindness. If they go out into the streets, they're going to find Reservoir Dogs every day. I mean, you know, and it's simply an expression of what already is.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I can't believe you killed me.
I think the movies have made too much play of things that are deeply painful.
The kind of loss of humanity by having violence portrayed without any understanding of what is going on that makes people violent in that way. And that's where you lose.
Is he dead?
You have a choice. You don't have to watch it. You don't have to have your children watch it or anything else. They just don't tune in. But for those people who are interested in looking human nature in the eye and seeing for what we really are, and then going on and doing the best we can with what we are, then a film like Reservoir Dogs or any other film of quality, of course, should be on television and anywhere else.
As a filmmaker, I think it's wonderful. It's tremendous. As a business person, it makes good economic common sense, and they're going to make a good profit on it, and it's a springboard for Channel 4 saying, look how innovative and how courageous that we are, and it's an excellent decision. And as a father with parents, if I had children that are under 12 years old, it is my job as a father to say that you're not allowed to see this.
Oh, they're going to put this on public TV?
That's the reason for this documentary.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
They're going to put it on cut? Cool. Well, the waiting's almost over. Coming up in just a few minutes here on 4, the television premiere of Tarantino's Reservoir Dogs.